You've been seeing this SGI Visual Workstation 230 already last year. Officially, it supports Pentium 3 CPUs up to 800 MHz. But here, I have a 1 GHz CPU, and today, we're gonna find out if that is any good to work in this machine. Obsolete computer technology is my passion. I'm the vintage collector, and these are my stories. This episode is sponsored by PCBWay.com, your source for CNC machining, 3D printing, PCBs and more. So I got myself this used Pentium 3 1 GHz model, DSL52R, which runs on a 133 MHz frontside bus clock. This one is built on the copper mine core, which is as important as only this is supported by the VIA Polo Pro 133A chipset on this mainboard, but not the later 2-Latin cores. Admittedly, the 1 GHz copper mine is not the top speed CPU, as Intel released as well a 1.13 GHz model. However, the 1.13 GHz copper mines were also initially plagued by stability and performance issues when released in the year 2000 and demanded for a re-release in 2001.
That reminds me of another famous CPU bug.
I couldn't manage to obtain a sample of the fixed CD0 stepping, hence I stick with the 1 GHz CPU for today. However, I believe that the fixed 1.13 GHz copper mine should also work in this mainboard. At first, I want to dig into the jumper settings for the clock multipliers and debunk the first mystery. It's as important to know that the mainboard used for this SGI machine was not an in-house development by Silicon Graphics. They specifically used the Acer M23D mainboard, which also was used in the Acer Alta 350 and a few other machines. Both the user manuals by SGI and Acer don't document any further CPU clock multipliers than 6x, so that would equate to a maximum 600 MHz when running on a 100 MHz bus clock, or 800 MHz when running on a 133 MHz bus clock. However, both manuals also include a statement that the CPU frequency is automatically set and should not be tampered with. And the Acer manual goes even as far to mention 866 MHz CPUs, indicating that the mainboard should in fact support faster clock CPUs. For certain, the VIA Polo Pro 133A chipset does, and is also good for running up to 1.13 GHz CPUs, although, as mentioned, the copper mine cores only.
Don't try 2-Latin cores on this mainboard, as these need the VIA Polo 133T chipset.
Having said that, I'll check the jumper settings and find that what's currently configured would equate to a 2.5 multiplier. Now, while that would only give me a 333 MHz CPU clock, that doesn't match up with what I see in the BIOS, stating it is a 733 MHz CPU. So even after changing the jumpers to the correct position for a 5.5 multiplier, the CPU is, no surprise, still recognized as a 733 MHz CPU. So in this perspective, the statement about the auto-detection on the mainboard is correct.
Maybe you should try disabling the auto-detection.
I tried, but there's no jumper or BIOS setting to actually disable this behavior. And as much as I would have liked to document the additional clock multipliers, it seems to be totally superfluous anyways. And this is where my episode sponsor for today, PCBWay, comes into play. PCBWay offers a wide range of services around CNC machining, PCB production, including full assembly services and 3D printing on over a dozen of prototyping materials. For any electronic project you publish to the PCBWay community, you'll receive a 10% kickback on production cost if it's picked up for production by someone else. Use the link in the video description below to join up with PCBWay. So I take it from here to install the 1 GHz CPU upgrade. least the machine turns on, though I get this error message stating a mismatch in the CPU BIOS update code. What this means is that the currently installed BIOS doesn't have the proper CPU microcodes included for the 1 GHz CPU. Hence, I always have to press a key to force the machine to boot. And while it does start Windows 2000 just fine, and even the benchmark giving adequate results for the installed CPU, I have to do something about this annoyance. The solution is simple, I have to update the BIOS with the new CPU signatures to make it work correctly with this machine. Although it may appear to work correctly even without an updated BIOS, random issues might occur making this step necessary. Now, I would actually have loved to update the BIOS myself, as such procedures are well documented, and I did that already once at an earlier occasion. But these procedures mostly apply to AMI, Award or Phoenix, but not the generic Acer BIOS, which is an in-house development. And luckily, there's more recent BIOS versions available here, so I might not need to undergo that procedure anyway, if I only had the flash utility. And this is where my journey started, walking through many websites. And it goes not without saying that literally everywhere I ended up on dead links. Even when browsing the Acer website on archive.org, I found that the FTP links were not archived. But eventually, after asking the community, I was pointed at an archived copy of the Acer FTP site, which didn't actually include the searched for file, the A-Flash Utility version 3. Now, I actually downloaded several versions, only to find some not being DOS utilities. But the version 3.11-22 then actually was, and started up. So before tampering with the BIOS, I took a dump of the original BIOS version. The utility also provides a function to load the BIOS to memory buffer first, so as to inspect if it's readable. And both of them seem to be fine, so that's promising after all. I then opted to take the newest of the two to update the BIOS.
Just be aware, you bricked a few machines already before doing BIOS updates.
Alright, that procedure seems to be completing just fine. Let's await the moment of truth. And it totally works. No more nagging about an invalid CPU code mismatch, hence no additional key press needed any longer to make it boot with that 1 GHz CPU. The only thing I lost because of this upgrade procedure is the SGI BIOS logo screen, as I flashed the stock Acer BIOS and not a modified SGI BIOS. But I think that's a small price to pay given the result. But since I kept the original CPU and also the BIOS dump, I can always revert this machine back to its original state. Maybe I'll come around a more recent SGI BIOS for this mainboard one day. And hopefully, I'll even find a 1.13 GHz Coppermine CPU, as I'd definitely like to see if that one works as well. At least, the mystery about the CPU support for this machine is finally solved, and from this day onward, it shall be official. Yes, it runs on 1 GHz. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday.